We will now move to the next session of the day, the quiz session. The quiz will be conducted by Dr. Manish Bansal. The moderators of this session will be Dr. Deepankar Dotto and Dr. Mahesh Chaudhary. And the adjudicators of this session will be Dr. J.C. Mohan, Dr. V. Amuthan, and Dr. Shourangshu Chatterjee. It is going to be an open quiz where everyone can participate.
Good afternoon, everybody. So it's a quiz time now. Dr. Manish Bansal is the quiz master. And I would request the moderators and adjudicators to take the seats. There will be 22 clips. So at the end of the video, there will be a question. The papers will be distributed amongst you. So please write down your name with your cell number at the top and write the answers giving the proper number of the question. So there will be 22 clips. Remember it, the question will be along with the clip. You write the answer according to the question. And those who are having tea outside, may I request all of them to come inside. Please call all your friends to participate. This is a session which you are going to enjoy, and all of us are looking forward for this session. So let us start the quiz session. Thank you.
We invite the quiz master, Dr. Manish Bansal, to take over and conduct the quiz. The moderators and the adjudicators are present. The moderators, Dr. Deepankar Dotto and Dr. Mahesh Chaudhary. The adjudicators, Dr. J.C. Mohan, Dr. V. Amuthan, and Dr. Shourangshu Chatterjee. So this is going to be an interesting session with everybody participating.
All right, so these people are going to mark it. Once they have finished it, those papers will be taken away, and then you are going to explain it. And if we agree with your explanation, then these people will get full marks for that. If there is some discrepancy, then marks will be suitably changed. Right? Okay, go ahead.
That's where we come in. That's where we come in.
Who is going to?
So, what?
Good evening.
Yeah.
What I would request, the organizers, Dr. Banerjee and others, I mean, there should be kind of equal number of people in both halves of the hall. I mean, there are more people, as I can see, on the right side than the left. So some people from the right could perhaps shift to the left, because the plan is when Dr. Bansal has run out with the questions and people have given the answer script should be taken away. I mean, the people from the right should give the answer script to the left and the vice versa, so that this half corrects the answers of that half, and that half corrects the answer of this half. Then we, the moderators, will take the sheets and finally tally the results and maybe announce the results a little later. It cannot be done right away. The organizers will tell when the final results will be allowed. So some people from this half of the hall, I will be grateful if they slip to the other half, so that there is equal number of, roughly equal number of people on both halves.
So basically, we'll be wanting you only to check the answer sheets of your colleagues, and that's why he's requesting you to divide yourself half on that side, half on this side.
Now, so the first question asks is, how many people on this side of the aisle are going to answer? Please raise your hands, we can count them. So let's count them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. And how many on this side? So almost equal number.
Okay.
They're all right.
Yeah.
If somebody gets two papers, it's fine.
But many are not willing to participate. Yeah. Let me tell you, the questions are not going to be difficult.
So anyone more can participate. Our guests from Bangladesh, why don't you all participate?
Except for the faculty members.
Even the people on the front row can also participate. So.
Okay, so shall we begin? You note down your name and mobile number clearly on the top of the answer sheet. And as Dr. Debika mentioned, there will be a question for each clip. You have to answer to the point clearly and completely. Okay? So this is the first clip. You have a four chamber view with color and an M mode. So the question is, what is the interpretation of color M mode here? What is the main abnormality you are seeing in this? And don't speak out answer. Okay, let's go to the next question. Question number two. The 2-year-old boy, this is his parasternal long axis view. What is the diagnosis?
That is easy.
Okay, question number three. A 32-year-old female presents with dyspnea and congestive heart failure. These are the echo images. What is the diagnosis? Question number four. So you have a parasternal long axis view here and an M mode. It's wrongly written as color M mode, it's just plain simple M mode. Look at these two views clearly, carefully, and then interpret the M mode. What is it showing? What is the main abnormality in this? Look at both the PLACS view and the M mode. Note from where the M mode line is passing. And then try to interpret the abnormality. What is happening here? Okay, we go to the next question. Question number 5. This patient is undergoing a major non-cardiac surgery. Now, as part of evaluation for that surgery, this test was done. So, you have to answer what is the surgery being planned and what does this echo show? And this is something which is very routinely done procedure for this particular purpose. Okay, we go to the next question. Question number 6. So we've got three views here. What is the valve disease shown in these images? All the images from the same patient. There's one clue here that the patient has a condition for which she has received Herceptin in past. So you know why Herceptin is used, and that should give you the clue what valve disease this patient is having. So three different views, three different valves shown in these three views. Okay, question number 7. A 28-year-old gentleman presented with intermittent swelling of legs and rapidly progressive weight loss for 2 months. And we have two images. One is apical 4-chamber view and second one subcostal view showing IVC right atrial junction. Now this the images shown are actually very classical presentation of this particular entity. Rapid weight loss for 2 months and these echo images. Young gentleman. So what is the likely diagnosis? We cannot be sure from the images alone, but as I'm telling you that this is the classical presentation for this particular condition. Next question. The two images, peristral long axis view and short axis view. What is the diagnosis? Question number 9. Three images from a 55-year-old gentleman. He's been having intermittent diarrhea and swelling of feet. Now this history should make it very simple. What is the main diagnosis? he has swelling of feet. Okay. Question number 10. Another 55 years old gentleman, alcoholic, he has undergone a procedure. From these two images, you have to identify what procedure he has undergone. And he is a chronic alcoholic. That is a very important history here. Okay, question number 11. There's a 52-year-old gentleman. He has presented with certain abnormality. Echo showed this. And now he will undergo a major non-cardiac surgery for the condition which he has presented with. So what is the underlying diagnosis which has resulted in this, and now is due to undergo a major non-cardiac surgery for that? Pardon me? That's what you have to tell me. What is the clinical presentation? Weight loss for 3 months. That's the main, and that's the main problem. Okay, question number 12. I am going to show you another slide, and after that you have to answer. This is a young gentleman who presented with pedal edema. These are two plaques images, one without color, second with color. You look at these carefully, then I'll go to the next slide. After that, you have to answer. Okay. So I'll go to the next slide, showing four chamber view. So this is a young male presented with pedal edema. You have to tell me what is the cause of his pedal edema. Okay, next question. Now this patient has undergone many procedures which you can make out from the fluoroscopy image, but he has undergone a procedure very recently that also you can make out from these two images. You tell me what is the procedure he has undergone recently, cardiac procedure. It's not ICD. So some other procedure has been done on him. the echo image and fluoroscopy together should tell you the answer. So the next question is very straightforward. I'll show you two slides and then you have to answer. You have to tell me the diagnosis and main findings. Okay, so this is the first slide, Flack's view and four chamber view. And mitral inflow pattern and GLS. This is a very, very classical case, classical images, garden variety. So you have to answer two main findings, any two findings, and diagnosis. Next question, question number 15. A 65-year-old lady underwent, she presented with very poor oral intake and marked emaciation. She underwent a palliative procedure. What was the procedure done on her? Question number 16. A 55-year-old gentleman had anterior wall MI. He undergoes PCI after 24 hours. This echo is done the next day. What is the diagnosis? Okay, next question. This is a color M mode. I'll not tell you the view. You have to mention the main finding and the diagnosis. Again, something very classical. Okay, next, question number 18. What is the complete diagnosis here? Okay, next question, question number 19, again a spot diagnosis. What is the diagnosis? Okay, question number 20. What is this entity called? You have got two transesophageal echo views. Again, a classical description of this entity. Next question, question number 21. What is this phenomenon happening here? There is a specific term for this. So we go to the last question now. This is a transesophageal 3D showing mitral valve. There are two main abnormalities which you can see in this view. You have to describe these two mitral valve abnormalities.
Now you can take another 5 minutes to see that you have answered them correctly, then exchange with the other half.
Yeah, we will collect the answer sheets from this half and this half separately, and we'll then pass on to the other half.
So that please do not forget to write your name and the mobile phone number on top of the sheet.
Give them a few more minutes actually to check that they have put their name. Any last minute change of mind?
I don't think that would help. They would only discuss them.
when the answer sheets are being collected, do the adjudicators have anything to comment? Dr. Mohan?
Yes.
Anything you want to comment on these questions or anything
no, it was a reasonable mixture of easy cases and not so easy. And anybody who scores more than 60% would be considered an excellent echocardiograph. That's how I would interpret these things, 60% and more. There are some things which are a little difficult. I would have kept the distinction at 75%, but I'll keep the distinction at 60% at the moment.
Would you recommend any extra prize if somebody gets the answer more than 75%?
Pardon?
Would you recommend some extra prizes for somebody who answers more than 75%?
We'll see the images later on.
See, the point is there are always some people who are better than you and me. And maybe somebody might even match Manish Mansal, who knows. What I'm trying to say is, we are trying to look at, regular kind of guys should be able to get about 22 out of 22, I think about 14 questions all right. That's what I am trying to look at.
Minimum 10.
Dr. Amuthan, anything to add?
Shall we start?
Yeah, exchange done?
Exchange.
No.
Papers have been collected.
They need some more time.
4 marks for a correct answer, 2 marks for half.
I'll explain.
Each question 2 marks.
So each question has 2 marks.
Actually, on the answer sheet it's written 4 marks, but I suggest we keep 2 marks for correct answer. Some questions had 2 parts. So 1 mark each for each correct answer, each part, you interchange, and 0 for wrong answer.
0, 1 and 2.
2 for correct answer and 0 for wrong answer for most of the questions, but some questions had 2 parts. So there, 1 mark for each part.
1 mark we will do arbitration here. For 1 mark we will do arbitration when you present.
Okay.
2 and 0 are all right.
Yes.
So let's get going.
So there is little change from what is printed below the answer sheets. It's written 4 and 2. Instead of 4 and 2, it will be 2, 1, 0. But as Dr. Mohan says, it's either 2 and 0. 1 is up to the adjudicators.
Yeah. You quickly distribute the answer sheets so that we can start. You could take extra help in distributing these quickly.
Participate and tell the answer.
One coffee, sir. If you get tea.
What happened?
Tea.
2, 3 left.
One coffee. One tea.
Not this side. Distribute.
Sir, you want coffee or tea?
To that side only. If you're not able to find people, you get the answer sheets, we'll check it later because we'll have to start. Get that one also? Okay. Okay. So let us start. This was question 1 and you were asked to answer what was shown in this color M mode. So as you can make out, here what we are seeing is diastolic MR. It's very easily appreciable in the color mode. Here is the QRS. After QRS, you have this initial systolic MR, then forward flow during early part of diastole, and then in the second half, there is this diastolic MR. Okay. I think
two jets.
Now those who write diastolic MR get 2, those who don't write it get 0.
Diastolic MR has to be mentioned.
Only correct answer is diastolic MR. Nothing. I'm not able to hear you.
No more is required. You write diastolic MR, you get 2 marks. You don't write diastolic MR, you get 0.
Plain MR, no marks. Diastolic MR,
why
2 marks.
Perhaps you could explain why the diastolic MR is occurring.
I don't think that will be required.
No, that's
prolonged PR interval is not an MOD finding.
Elevated LV EDP.
No, that is not a required thing, sir, but it's a learning for all of us. As far as I can make out, there's a very prolonged PR interval.
You can make it out from the color also.
Diastolic MR will occur in two different conditions. If there's AV dissociation or if there's significant increase in LV EDP because of anything. Or when a mitral valve opens prematurely, when the diastole has not finished. So in this case, if you see here, PR interval is markedly prolonged. So atrial opening is resulting in opening, atrial kick is opening the mitral valve when the LV is, LV EDP is still high, and that's why towards the end there is diastolic MR. So this was the second clip. 2 year old boy, what we find here is this marked hyper. No, diastolic MR.
CHB has answer, he has written.
Answer is diastolic MR, 0 marks for that. So this is marked severe left ventricular hypertrophy in a 2-year-old boy. The most likely diagnosis would be Noonan syndrome. Because that's what is characterized by hypertrophy at birth. So hypertrophy is not the correct answer. Correct answer would be Noonan syndrome. Now this is third patient. What we find here is one that left ventricle, right ventricular systolic function appears to be normal. They are of normal size, but LARA are dilated, and both ventricular apices are obliterated here. In peristal long axis view, what we find is that PML is almost plastered to the posterior wall, resulting in eccentric posteriorly directed MR. So these echo findings are quite classical of hyper eosinophilic syndrome.
So if it is, you have written endomyogranulocytic fibrosis or biventricular endomyogranulocytic fibrosis, you get 2 marks, and you have written anything other than that, you get 0.
Yes. So HES or EMF, 2 marks.
EMF.
So even if you write EMF or biventricular EMF, either of the two will give you 2 marks.
Written restrictive cardiomyopathy.
No. No marks for that.
Mural thrombosis there is endomyocardial fibrosis.
Okay, next question. This was a little bit challenging. So here, see this M mode line is passing through the aortic valve. You look at this peristernal long axis view. Aortic valve is not opening at all. And this you can make out from this M mode also. This aortic leaflets they remain closed throughout the cardiac cycle, but heart is contracting. So exactly, there is only one explanation, that the patient is on an LVAD. Okay, so these are the outflow cannula of the LVAD. You can see the device here near the LV apex. So because LVAD will put will draw blood from left ventricle and will put it directly into the aorta, aortic valve does not open. So the answer will be aortic valve not opening because of LVAD. Now here what we are seeing is, the question was the patient is undergoing major non-cardiac surgery and we are doing a pre-surgery workup. So here this agitated saline injection is being given to look for hepatopulmonary shunting, and this is done routinely before liver transplant surgery in patients with cirrhosis. Because cirrhosis patients often have HPS, which leads to desaturation, it increases surgical mortality, it worsens outcome. So they routinely exclude HPS by doing agitated saline injection. So there were two questions, answer first liver transplant and second is HPS. Okay. So here the history was that the patient had received Herceptin. Herceptin, as we know, is trastuzumab used for CA breast. Now this lady has multivalvular involvement. Mitral leaflets are thickened, tricuspid leaflets are thickened, aortic leaflets are thickened. And here, I mean, there is no commissural fusion here. The thickening of leaflets of the mitral valves at the bases, and there is thickening of both the tricuspid leaflets seen here. This is because of radiation. The patient received chemotherapy, after that she underwent radiotherapy, and this is radiation-induced valvulitis.
So those who write radiation valvulopathy get 2 marks, and those who write anything other than that, 0 marks. Radiation multivalvular radiation, or you could call radiation multivalvulopathy, that's all, or radiation valvulopathy, radiation valvular heart disease. Any of those will get 2 marks.
Yes. Okay, so here what we see is that there is a multilobulated mass in the right atrium just at the IVC-RA junction. This is 28-year-old gentleman who presented with rapidly progressive weight loss for 2 months. So the one of the DDs here would be angiosarcoma, because this is a typical presentation of angiosarcoma. It has great predilection for IVC-RA junction, and it is a malignant tumor, highly malignant tumor, so the history is short and very rapid clinical presentation. Angiosarcoma. Okay, question number 8. So, two images I showed you. This is a pastoral long axis view. You see the flow here in the in the region of the anterior interventricular groove, and in the short axis you can easily make out markedly dilated right coronary artery. We can't see left coronary artery entering here, so we cannot be sure of that because the view is not aligned properly. But these flows here and such dilated RCA would tell you that the diagnosis was ALCAPA. And as you can see here, left coronary artery was dilated, draining into the pulmonary MPA.
So, Bland White Garland syndrome or ALCAPA, 2 marks, anything other than that, 0 marks. ALCAPA, 2 marks, anything other than that, 0 marks.
Left coronary artery is not seen in the short axis view.
This is left
dilated
coronary artery.
Right coronary artery with a turbulent flow.
Earlier clip, okay.
Usually dilated right coronary artery and blood in the collateral, in the interventricular septum coming towards the aorta.
Exactly.
Okay, question number 9. This should have been, I think, straightforward. Diarrhea. And mitral valve is normal, but pulmonary valve and tricuspid valve are thickened, non-coapting. Diagnosis? Carcinoid. Question number 10. This is a 55-year-old alcoholic, chronic alcoholic. He has undergone a procedure. So, if you look at this subcostal view, you can see something in the IVC-RA junction, which is seen in this view also, something entering from IVC into the right atrium. So this patient underwent a procedure called TIPS, which is done in patients with severe portal hypertension, cirrhosis.
Answer is TIPS.
If yeah.
Anything other than TIPS, 0.
TIPS. Stenting will not be sufficient. Because stenting could be for any reason, even IVC stenosis for some reason could require stenting.
So it is a transinternal jugular portosystemic shunting.
Okay. So here I mentioned that this patient 52-year-old gentleman presented with weight loss. These were the echo findings, and then he was planned for a major non-cardiac surgery. So we are seeing here there is a thrombus extending all along the IVC into the right atrium. This is a typical presentation of RCC.
So if you write thrombus in transition, you get 1 mark, and if you write RCC with thrombus in transition, 2 marks. RCC with thrombus in transition, 2 marks. Only thrombus in transition, 1 mark.
Someone is asking, only RCC? Only RCC.
Only RCC should get 1 mark, because the other thing is not being described.
He wants the full form of RCC.
He can give
excuse
two
me,
marks.
Sir.
So we, you know, we are, so if you write thrombus in transition due to RCC, you get full marks. You write RCC will give you full marks.
Thank you so much.
Okay, we'll give you full marks. 2 marks for each. Okay. Anything else? Okay.
Okay, fine. Next question. This was a little bit tricky. The young male presented with pedal edema. I asked you the reason for pedal edema. So in this, we are seeing a membrane in the left atrium. You can see flow through that. So this patient has core triatriatum. But this was not the cause for pedal edema. Core triatriatum would lead to pedal edema only if it leads to such severe PH that there is right heart failure. But you look at the images again. I'll go to this previous once more. Look at this septum. There is marked septal bounce. There is pericardial thickening here. And in four chamber view, you can see circumferential pericardial thickening, marked septal bounce. RARV are not dilated. There is no suggestion of pulmonary hypertension. Even the membrane was not obstructive, because the color flow through the membrane, if you see, it's not turbulent. It's non-turbulent flow. So this was just an incidental diagnosis. The patient actually had chronic constrictive pericarditis, which was the cause of pedal edema. So constrictive pericarditis, 2 marks, and anything else, 0 marks.
So I think somebody who writes only quadritum sinister,
yes,
you see the longitudinal function of the RVD decrease. So if you write even that and don't write constriction, we are ready to give you 2 marks. I'll tell you why. Although you have not, the septal bounce is very classic, but here is an issue. The patient has evidence of right ventricle dysfunction without dilatation, and there is evidence of some right ventricle hypertrophy. So we will even give you 2 marks even if you write core triatrium sinister. So we are modifying what Dr. Manish is saying. Okay, happy. Go ahead.
Okay. No, he is saying, if you have written core triatrium sinister, then also 2 marks and constrictive pericarditis. But sir, if someone has written constrictive pericarditis, some bonus marks need to be given.
Yes, sir. Constrictive is difficult to without the Doppler parameters.
Anyway, let's move ahead. Okay, so this was mitral inflow in this patient. This was IVC, markedly dilated, non-collapsing, all features of constriction. Okay, question number 13. So I told you that the patient has undergone many procedures. I wanted you to answer which was the most recent. See, this patient has undergone previous cardiac surgery. You can make out these sternal wires. So some valves, some kind of cardiac surgery has been done. ICD was put in sometimes back. ICD, yeah. Now, look at this. This is not the usual surgical mitral valve. This is a TAVR valve, Sapien's valve, in mitral position. Look at this here. Mitral leaflets are quite pliable, opening very well, and this cage of the mitral valve is quite long. So this patient underwent bioprosthetic mitral valve implantation sometimes in past, and he has now undergone valve-in-valve procedure, which Dr. Chandrasekhar also showed you during the daytime. So this valve, this image here should tell you that this is a TAVR valve positioned here, and Here are the two images, just before the procedure and after the procedure. Look at this mitral valve here. Both the leaflets are markedly thickened, calcific, hardly opening. And here, after the procedure, we have a very well functioning sapiens valve implanted in the mitral position. Okay, so answer, correct answer is transcatheter MVR, TMVR, or valve-in-valve procedure. Okay, so this was classical amyloidosis. You see, marked hypertrophy, restrictive MIP, and apical sparing on longitudinal strain. So any two findings, it could be hypertrophy, it could be restrictive MIP or apical sparing, plus diagnosis, cardiac amyloidosis.
There are two parts, so two findings and the diagnosis, one mark each.
Okay.
I think anybody who has written cardiac amyloidosis gets two both the marks. Yes. Cherry on top, you need not be described. Two marks for cardiac amyloidosis.
Okay.
No, restrictive or no marks?
No marks.
No, because the acoustic speckle pattern is so classic that if you write
bullseye scene,
you don't get any marks.
Restrictive cardiomyopathy will not be acceptable. Okay, so this 65-year-old lady presented with very poor oral intake and marked emaciation. She underwent a palliative procedure. Now, the procedure she underwent was not a cardiac procedure. She underwent esophageal stenting, and you can clearly see this stent in short axis here, even here also, just behind the left atrium.
So, esophageal stent implantation, 2 marks. Anything other than that, 0 marks. Stent is clearly visible in esophagus.
Yes.
I mean, it cannot be better than that.
This is a condition very favorite of Dr. Mohan.
So, anybody written dissecting intramyocardial hematoma gets 2 marks. Anything other than that, 0. This. Oh, 2 marks.
Yeah. 2 marks. 2 marks.
You, if you write myocardial dissection, intramyocardial hematoma, dissecting hematoma, that's all 2 marks. Anything other than that, 0 marks.
So, if you have written clot or anything else, pseudoaneurysm, clot, aneurysm, 0 marks.
No clot.
Yeah. So, what happens is that because of myocardial necrosis, there is damage to the capillaries, and when reperfusion is done after a delay, there is leakage of blood into the myocardium, which leads to the formation of intramural hematoma. This is a very common condition, but often overlooked, and we have started diagnosing it very frequently after being shown repeated examples by Dr. Mohan.
So, I don't know why, but I end up seeing actually one case every week now. I don't know what's happening, really, because this delayed angioplasty is so common, plus also those people who present late, even if they have conservative management, myocardial hematoma is being seen more often. Now that we are aware of it, we are seeing quite often. At least in my lab, people are aware, so they will always call me. There is another case, there is another case.
We are also seeing almost one case every week. Okay. This again was simple, relatively simple. You have a short axis of the LV here, and the M mode line is passing through the mitral leaflets. What we see here is that during systole, immediately after QRS, this anterior mitral leaflet is getting dragged towards the septum. Because of that, there is turbulence here, LVOT obstruction. So this is basically a case of hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy. The main findings are SAM and LVOTO, and diagnosis is HOCM.
So you write HOCM, you get 2 marks. You explain it, SAM with turbulence in the LVOT, you get 2 marks. Anything other than that, you get 0. Okay, SAM with HOCM, 2 marks.
Okay, next question. Oh, this is images from the same patient. We can clearly see SAM here. This was submitral aneurysm with perforation of PML. So we asked complete diagnosis. Both entities are needed in diagnosis. Perforation. If only one is described, then 1 mark.
PML aneurysm with hole or perforation, 2 marks. Anything other than that, he said, if you write one mark, we'll give it.
PML perforation, 1 mark.
Only if you write a hole in the PML, we'll give you 1 mark.
Okay, next was, this is spot diagnosis, AP window.
Okay. AP window?
You see two semilunar valves here and no partition between aorta and pulmonary artery. Okay. Now this is T showing interatrial septum. This is marked dumbbell shape appearance of the interatrial septum. This is lipomatous hypertrophy of IAS.
Lipomatous hypertrophy of atrial septum, 2 marks. Anything other than that, 0 marks.
Question number 21.
See, the fossa ovalis is thinned, and above and below that you see the thickening, the atrial septum.
Yeah, fossa ovalis is spared, but above and below fossa ovalis you see this marked thickening. Okay, so here what we are seeing is an artifact known as electromechanical interference. It happens because of the use of cautery while you are doing TE. So this image was taken intraoperatively when the patient was undergoing a cardiac surgery. So surgeons were using cautery and we were doing TE. So these wavy patterns, you can get any kind of funny patterns because of this electromechanical interference. Okay, and the last question, describe the mitral valve abnormalities. So this is 3D TE image. We are seeing mitral valve from the left atrial side. Aortic valve is on the top, which is the convention. This is AML, this is PML. Now what we see here is there is a big perforation in the most medial scallop of the AML, because here would be the commissure. So this is A3 perforation, and center part, which is A2, is prolapsing. So
prolapse, 1 mark.
A2 prolapse and A3 perforation, these were the correct findings, but if you have written AML prolapse and perforation, I think that will be acceptable.
Perforation 1 mark and prolapse is 1 mark.
Yeah, perforation 1.
No, A2 and A8.
A2 is prolapsing?
A2 mainly.
Little bit is there. Isn't
won't make much of a difference as long as you write AML prolapse and perforation.
Okay, AML prolapse and perforation.
So this was a young lady who had come from one of the African countries. She had HIV. She had come with fever. She had infective endocarditis. You see here, there is abscess formation followed by perforation of AML with severe MR. Thank you.
Very nice collection of quiz questions.
AML prolapse.
Please, now you can give back those papers and Dr. Dutta will look at it. You can mark it. Final marks at the top.
Yeah, you just make a total of the marks.
After
and
you
then
mark
write it,
please submit the answer sheet.
How many prizes, sir?
Yes, so the Debika, how many prizes? 3 prizes. First, second, third. First person gets 3 BHK house, second 2 BHK, and third person gets 1 BHK. Right in Salt Lake City. First prize 10,000 rupees. Second is 7,500.
5,000
rupees.
All the three will get certificates.
So 10,000, 7,500, 5,000. Not dollars, INR. and a certificate also. Certificate will be mailed to you in case it is not ready at the moment. Before you finish the conference, certificate not ready, it will be mailed to you. Kindly leave your email address and we'll courier, and also your address, we'll courier to you. 5 minutes break before we start with the next program, because Dr. Datta is collating everything. And our job is over, so we are...
Sir, we cannot announce the prizes now. It will take a lot of time to correct those. Tabulate and correct those.
So you get going. Actually, we go on with the next program.
No, the organizers, Arunangshu, when do you plan to announce the prizes?
Tomorrow,
when? I mean, you tell everybody. They are willing to know. They are eager to know when you are going to announce. Okay. So the results will be announced tomorrow before the lunch.
We come to the end of the quiz session. The academic quiz sure had kept everyone truly engrossed. Dr. Bansal had put much thought into preparing the quiz, as it did make everyone put on their thinking caps, particularly for the not so easy questions, as Dr. Mohan has described some of the questions. Enthusiastic participation is also an indicator of how one always wishes to test oneself to stay on top. We thank the moderator of this session, Dr. Dipankar Dotto, and the adjudicators of this session, Dr. J.C. Mohan, Dr. V. Amuthan, and Dr. Shorangshu Chatterjee.